time to watch Patrick Mahomes win another Super Bowl.
Mahomes.
I am not obsessed with Patrick Mahomes. Talent just recognizes talent.
Mahomes.
There we go.
What a play. What a play.
You know, he got drafted in the MLB, too, right? Oh, I tell you what, I'd like to see that kid pitch 9 innings. Oh, jeez. We're not talking about Mahomes' brother. He's just a kid. He's just got some growing up to do. And from what I hear, he's a pretty good dancer. Just leave it alone, Chantel.
You seen my Chiefs tailgating truck? Spent 2.5 years on it. Go Chiefs. Got that Patrick Mahomes right there.
The tranny is slipping a little bit right now, though, so she's kind of limping along, but so is Mahomes.
Darts! Welcome to the Red Kingdom!
Mahomes!
Oh, Patrick. That Patrick is good. I wish Patrick was my son.
Well, good morning and welcome to Hillcrest. Please stand and sing with us.
When all I see is a battle, you see my victory. When all I see is a mountain, you see a mountain moved. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear.
So
battle belongs to you.
Thank you, worship team. Go and have a quick seat. We are glad that you are here this morning. Super Bowl Sunday. Quick show of hands. How many of you think the Chiefs are winning today? You would be wrong. How many of you think the Eagles are winning today? Yeah. Cowboys. The Cowboys are playing the Vikings in the Puppy Bowl. So, boom, there we go. All right. Well, you got to kind of have to pick an activity or a game on a Sunday like today. So we showed you a Super Bowl video, and we're going to do a Valentine's game because Valentine's is coming up on Tuesday. So, fellas, still a couple of days left for you to do that shopping. But here we go. Two kinds of people, Valentine's Day edition. Which one are you? Here's the first one. How many of you are the fast food? Let's grab, you know, McDonald's. How many of you are a nicer meal, more of an Italian? All right, good. Good church. Good job. Okay. Second one. How many of you are the teddy bear type of people? Okay. Flowers. You can't do like the nun, okay? Like, you got to choose. This is how this works. Here's the last one. How many of you the rom-com, the romantic movie people? How many of you want to watch a good old military film on Valentine's Day? No, nothing says love like D-Day. Well, we got five more of those in the Facebook group. If you're not a part of that, make sure you join that. We'll get to know you a little bit better this week. Streaming right now on YouTube. Shout out to those of you joining us on that service, 10:30 service on Facebook. You can give via those options. Also, given the Church Center app or in the towers in back. Rend Collective Concert coming up on March 31st. We're bringing a group from here to that show. If you're interested in tickets, please sign up for those tickets by this Wednesday, February 15th, so we can get you seated together. Family Game Night coming up Sunday, February 26th from 4 to 6 p.m. Join us for that as Pastor Trina leads us in a riveting game of Monopoly. So
never.
That's her favorite game. She loves it.
No matter how cute the kids are.
Plays it every weekend. Loves never. Monopoly.
Never.
Loves Monopoly.
I'll play Uno.
A couple bonus announcements here for you that aren't on this screen. I want to say happy birthday to Jackie McNamara. Happy birthday, Jackie. Yeah, that's her right there. Yeah, give her a clap. Good. And then over here, one of our ministries is adoption and foster care. Part of that is Harbor Families, and we just started this ministry. I want to let you know, we just had our first placement here this weekend. Darren and Missy Davis have a three-year-old that's with them for the next few weeks, and so be praying for them and thinking of them as they kind of make their way with that transition. But so cool. Wanted to recognize that. Why don't you stand at this time, and Kels and the team will lead us in some singing.
Still, you are you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful.
For your faithfulness. I pray that every person that has come this morning prayed up and ready to hear from you can reflect back that your goodness has ran for us, that you are the same God today as you were yesterday. Lord, you are faithful and you love us and we thank you. Lord, we pray that this morning that we would be listeners and learners, that we would take this message, we would take these Goliaths and these giants in our lives and defeat them and know, Lord, that you've gone before us. We'd be a bright light in this world. We love you, Jesus. Amen. You may be seated.
Well, good morning. Welcome to this summer day in February. Boy, the weather, what a switch. It's kind of funny. Yesterday, I was went to Hy-Vee to grab a few things, and there were a couple of guys in shorts and tank tops. And I didn't say anything to them because, you know, you be you. And as they were heading out, though, we were kind of walking out at the same time. And they're like, it's so great, because, like, if this was, like, fall, we'd be in parkas. But, you know, because it's now, we're in shorts and tanks. So I'm like, well, they get it, you know. It wasn't that warm out. But still, well, just great. My dog, you know, we have to take our dog out to use the bathroom. It's just nice not to, like, dress up, like put all the gear on, you know, to take the dog out. So that's great for us. But this week, as we get started, I want to address something from last week, because I was almost, I would say, inundated is a good word for this, by many of you with messages and texts asking the question, did you make the football team? So if you were here last week, I talked about me going out for this football team, and I never said that I did or didn't. It wasn't to me, that was just like secondary. Apparently for the rest of you, you're waiting with bated breath whether I made it or not. So I answered many of you, but I figured I would answer that today as well. Now, for those of you who weren't here last week, yes, in high school, my junior year, I went out for football at a school that was a championship level team. And so what business did I have in doing that? Well, yes, I did make the team, and I started. So I had some success there. In no way was I good, but good enough to play and had a great time. In fact, here's a photo of myself and my defensive lineman. So that's me up there. Standing to my left is Coach Tom Deal, mentor in my life, encouraged me in a lot of ways. So good memories of those days. Now, interestingly, Louis Giglio, if you're following along with Right Now Media, for this topic in his Bible study, that the giant of comfort must fall, he actually talks about and references the Super Bowl, because it's happening like right around that time that he is giving that talk. I just think that's kind of interesting, because that's literally just coincidence. But he uses this illustration of the Super Bowl by saying, you know, on Super Bowl Sunday, people are going to gather in their homes, and they're going to make sure they have all the proper snacks that they need. Doesn't matter what it is, you make sure you've got it. If it's chicken wings or like little smokies or meatballs, you know, or, you know, whatever your thing might be, whatever your beverage of choice is, and you're stocked up, ready to go. And some people go out and buy the big screen TV. Some people go out and even purchase like certain kinds of seating, like new couches or lazy boys. You want to be comfortable. You want to have all the food that you need, more than any human being could possibly consume. And you want the TV like you're at the stadium, large and in charge, in your face, sound, and this is the whole deal. And what you're doing is you're creating like this level of comfort to watch the game. And what you're watching is men on a football field that crash into each other, that injure each other, that are going to get carted off the field with broken bones and concussions and all these other kinds of things. And it's just like, in many ways, like a modern day blood sport out there. And we're going to be in as much comfort as possible watching men in the most uncomfortable time of their week. Now, they're doing it by their choice. It's part of the game. All the sweat and tears and, you know, that go into all that they did to prepare for this moment in their life, to be on stage and to perform in front of us as we just sit there and say, I'll have another chicken wing, please, or some more queso dip. We're in comfort and they are in discomfort. He tells that story to illustrate this fact. He says, I wonder if that is not a good illustration for the modern church. That we come together in churches focused on comfort, to sing songs and worship a Jesus who lived a very uncomfortable life, who lived in discomfort. So in our comfort, we worship one that was in discomfort. And he says, I wonder if that is not what the modern church is. And we've kind of lost connection with this. And it's hard to really worship and understand the discomfort of Jesus if we ourselves aren't in discomfort, if we don't put ourselves in uncomfortable spots as it relates to our faith and our growth and what it is, our purpose and what we're about, our mission here on this earth. And so that was kind of the challenge as he starts off with this series. It could be that the giant of comfort has fooled us into giving up on this idea that comfort can be one of the greatest tools to help us become who God calls us to be. What do you think of that statement? Discomfort? Do you see that as a tool that can be used in your life to help you become who God wants you to be? Now, when you look at this story of David and Goliath, there is a question that is raised in the minds of the reader as they read the story that I believe the story is trying to accent for us at the beginning. A part of the story that begs the question, why did King Saul allow Goliath to, for over a month, taunt Israel? Why did he allow that? I think it's a question that comes up in this story. I think it's a question we're supposed to be asking. And I think, of course, the story is going to answer that question. It's maybe one of many questions that, of course, develop within this amazing story that has been passed on to us. But why did he allow this giant to taunt Israel for over a month? Saul was king. And he was the very first king that Israel ever had. He was the first of many kings. But when the people cried out for a king, and God was like, you don't need a king, you've got me. And they're like, we want a king. And he's like, okay, I will give you your wish. And that started the line of kings. So the very first king was King Saul. And just like David was anointed by the prophet to become king, this prophet also anointed Saul's head to become king. This was the very first king. And Saul was kingly, let's say. I mean, he was a handsome guy, but he was capable. And if you look at Saul's life, his story leading up to him becoming king, and even, you know, those first bits or first time of being king, he was well-suited for it. He came from the smallest of the Israel tribes. He came from the tribe of Benjamin. Now, anybody know anyone in the scripture that was from the tribe of Benjamin that something kind of unique happened with? Do you remember the slaying of King Ehud by the left-handed warrior? He snuck in because he was left-handed. And so usually when they would pat people down, you know, they were, I guess, cutting corners, and everyone's right-handed, so you'd keep your you know, knife on the left side to draw. Well, if you're a left-handed warrior, it's on this side. There weren't a lot of left-handed warriors. Well, the tribe of Benjamin was known to be left-handed warriors, and they were a warrior tribe. I mean, they were a fierce tribe, but they were small. But this is where Saul came from. Was he left-handed? I don't know that, but I guarantee he was probably trained in fighting that way because that was part of their ability or their kind of stealth action in a fight, is that they could fight uniquely and differently because people weren't trained against a left-handed fighter because everybody fighted right hand. But Samuel anointed him as the king. Saul was loved. He was respected by the people. And he had already won many different battles against Israel's enemies. Some of those would be the Ammonites, the Edomites, the Moabites, the Amalekites, and even won some wars against Israel's strongest and most fierce enemy, and that's the Philistines, which is, of course, what we have in front of us today with David and Goliath. It's the Philistines. He was not only brave and capable, but he was a brilliant military strategist. That's probably what Saul is known for the most, is his ability to strategize in these military situations, to be able to think through those battles, not just fight through the battles. 1 Samuel 17:16. For 40 days, every morning and evening, the Philistine champion strutted in front of the Israelite army, the army. What in the world is going on here? Why would this man that I just described to you allow this one person, yes, giant of a man, why would he let this one person taunt Israel day after day after day after day? And if I said day after day 40 times, you'd get the point. Every day, come out and listen to that. And then go back to what? Doing nothing all day long, sitting in your tent. just for the next day to get up and do it all over again? Why? I believe that the story is begging us to ask that question. Because if you knew anything about Saul, this is the kind of guy that would stand up to a guy like Goliath. And that's why he was chosen as king. That's why people revered him and respected him, is because of his ability and even to strategize around a situation like that. But instead, Saul just lets it happen day after day after day. Why? Saul had the best armor a man could possibly own. He had the best resources. He had the experience, the skill. In fact, Saul even offered that armor to David, if you remember. But David didn't take it. Saul would not face this giant himself. Which brings us to a truth that we all know. We don't like this truth, but it is a truth. That if we want to achieve something great in life, if we are to achieve something great in our lives, it's going to, before we achieve that greatness, there are going to be two paths in front of us. And one path is an easy path, and one path is a hard path, a difficult path, dare I say, a treacherous path, a dangerous path. Before us in life are always those two paths, the easy road and the hard road. And the things that are worth achieving, the things of significance, are found on that hard road. We know this to be true. We don't like it to be true. And yes, you might be able to pull out of some story somewhere how someone took the easy path and that's where they found their success. If you know that story, it's either a lie or such an anomaly, it's not worth discussing. Because for you and me, we know anything that we have done in life of any great significance has come at personal cost or some kind of cost, and with difficulty and endurance, maybe suffering and sacrifice. To do something good in life, to achieve something great, to achieve something worth achieving, there's going to be a difficult road that we have to take. And why is that? It's because in the hard times, the opportunity to become a better version of yourself is there. In difficult moments, that is where the opportunity lies for you to be a better version of yourself, to learn something along the way. Your character is shaped in hard times. Your values are better defined in those hard times. Your vision becomes clearer in hard times. Your purpose is revealed to you in those hard times, that difficult road. If our faith is filled with only comfort, if our focus in our faith journey or in our journey of life even is about comfort, our faith will become weak. If we focus on comfort in our life and never challenge ourselves in our day-to-day life and our relationships, our family, our jobs, our whatever it might be, we will become soft. We become lazy. We become insignificant. And when we do that in our faith and we choose comfort in our faith, yes, we will become weak, but we also become powerless. And dare I say, within our faith, we become worthless. Not much value to that. And we certainly in no way will represent the person of Jesus Christ, because that's not the way that he lived. Maybe so. There it is again. Hang with me. I'll put it up here. Think about the things that you know about Jesus. Jesus came with purpose, did he not? He came into this world with a very clear, very specific purpose, and that is to save us. To save you, to save me, to save your family, your friends, to save people. People need salvation, that's what he came for. The purpose was going to be uncomfortable for Jesus. Not just uncomfortable in the aspect of a crucifixion, like we know that. Obviously that was an uncomfortable event for Jesus, that was torturous for Jesus. But every day Jesus was on mission. And every day being on mission, there was discomfort in Jesus' life. In fact, I think as you look at his journey, people were always misrepresenting him. People were always trying to manipulate him in some way. There were people constantly mistreating him along the way, trying to get his message across and get people to grab a hold of this and hold on to the truth was difficult for Jesus, and it was a difficult journey. And with a comfort focus in our minds, if we hear about Jesus' story, there's a part of us that wants to say, that's just unfair for Jesus. It was unfair that he had such a difficult life because he was so good. Like, why didn't people just grab a hold of it? Like he deserved a break. He deserved a vacation. He deserved, like, an easier go at all this. In fact, we might have even said to the people of that day, like, hey, why can't, if you don't like what Jesus says, why can't you just say to him, like, okay, well, you do you and I'll do me. Why can't we just say, because that's what we tell each other in our world today. So we just want comfort, not to rattle someone's cage. But that's not what Jesus came for. Because Jesus also had two paths in front of him. And Jesus' path was uncomfortable. He knew that the uncomfortable path was the only path that would bring him glory, would bring God glory. And, of course, success of his purpose, his mission for being here. I believe that Jesus is trying to tell us, as you read the scriptures, he's trying to tell all of us that the path of discomfort is the better path. Don't choose the easy road, choose the more difficult road. In fact, in Mark chapter 8, if you look at verse 34 and 35, it says, then, calling the crowd to join his disciples, he said, if any of you wants to be my follower, you must turn from your selfish ways, take up your cross, and follow me. Okay, now, before I move on to the next verse, just hold on to that for a moment, okay? The crowds, he invited everyone that is wanting to hear what Jesus has to say, they're loving what Jesus has, and he brings them around, and he says, look, if you want to follow me, pick up the instrument of execution and join me on that path, the cross. Do you remember the man that came to Jesus and said, how can I have eternal life? And Jesus said, well, it's pretty simple. You just sell everything you have and give it away to the poor. And it says, and the man went away sad. The discomfort that following Jesus can create is too much for many people. We want comfort in our life and in our journey. So verse 35, he says, if you try to hang on to your life, and hear that as if you just want to live comfortably, if you just want to live your life the way it is, if you don't want to ruffle, you know, if you don't want waves, if you want just an easy go, if you want flat water, you're going to lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake and for the sake of the good news, you'll save it. It's tough, because the easy road is the one that we want, and Jesus says that's the road that you lose everything. And the road that we don't want to take is the difficult road, the hard road, and Jesus says if you take that, you're actually going to find your life, like you're going to find your meaning, your purpose. You see, when Jesus completed his purpose here on earth, he then gave us a purpose. When he completed his, he then gave that purpose to you and to me. We, each generation, is to continue the mission of Jesus. While I am on earth, while you're here on earth, while we're doing our lives here on earth, we're to fulfill the mission that he did while he was on earth. Jesus has given me that mission, and he's given you that mission. But the problem is this. In the Christian community that we have today, we have bought into this lie that's been told to us by this giant of comfort. And many have bought into the lie. Many have bought into this belief that life is about comfort. Life is about securing comfort. When I retire, securing comfort. Today when I watch the Super Bowl, securing comfort. In the job that I choose, securing comfort in every relationship that I have. That life in itself should always be the goal to have your life be pain-free, stress-free, difficulty-free. Many believe this. All the while, coming here, like on a Sunday morning, to celebrate Jesus, who lived something unrecognizable to that life of purposeless insignificance. Jesus' life does not resonate with a life of comfort. It can't be compared or matched up with. It's not in the same arena. It's not the other side of the same coin. It's unrecognizable to Jesus' life. Look, our faith thrives best in our discomfort. Faith thrives in discomfort. Your faith will thrive. Your faith does thrive. Your faith has thrived in discomfort. Think of your own journey. Because the way we live our life impacts the kind of faith that we're going to have. I mean, Jesus came to show us how to live a life that is full of meaning and purpose. And he said, a life built on anything outside of faith, a life built on anything other than faith in him, faith in this good news, is a life of foolishness. And I don't want to be a fool. In fact, he said it in Matthew chapter 7. He illustrated it this way. He says in verse 24, anyone who listens to my teaching and follows it is wise, like a person who builds his house on solid rock. Though the rain comes in torrents and the floodwaters rise and the wind beats against the house, it won't collapse because it is built on bedrock. Verse 26, he says, but anyone who hears my teaching and doesn't obey it is foolish, like a person who builds a house on sand. He says, when the rains and the floods come and the wind beats against that house, it will collapse. Not just collapse, but with a mighty crash. You see, when we choose to live a life of comfort, and that begins to be our goal, like to be comfortable in our lives, and we start to pursue that, that's our pursuit, is comfort, we lose the ability to weather the storms of life. Because, again, we get soft. A strong faith can weather the storms of life. And not only that, but the way Jesus teaches it and the truth of what we even see in our lives is that a life of faith can weather the storms and get stronger as a result of the storm. It's kind of like a tree that blows in the wind. You know, a tree that continues to get beat by the wind from a certain direction, that if you were to look underground, all the roots head towards the wind. If all of a sudden the wind shifted, went the other way, the tree would blow over. But it has learned how to weather that storm time after time after time, and it grows in such a way to weather the storm. With a person of faith, as you live strong in your faith and the storms come, you will weather them and you will become stronger as a result of the storm. And your life won't fall apart in a mighty crash. So, let's pick up this story. And I want to kind of back up on our story where David's father, Jesse, sends him to the battlefield to bring supplies to his three brothers who are fighting with Saul in the battlefield. And here you're going to see, as David shows up there where the battle is happening, you're going to see David experience this disconnect between Saul's faith and discomfort, not wanting to be uncomfortable. 1 Samuel 17, we're going to start at verse 17, so flip there if you would. One day, Jesus said to David, take this basket of roasted grain, these 10 loaves of bread, carry them quickly to your brothers, and give these 10 cuts of cheese to their captain. So here we have David bringing bread and cheese. Now, realize they didn't have MREs, meal ready to eat, in the military. Family actually brought food to you and the things you needed for daily life. And Jesse has told David, bring cheese and Bread and cheese. So if they were in Italy, this would be a pizza. If they were in Mexico, this is a quesadilla. Today, I think in our culture, this is called, what do we call it? A charcuterie board? Did I get that right? What? Charcuterie board. It's like Worcestershire sauce. It's hard to say. But, you know, it's French, I think. But that's the rage nowadays. But, you know, this is like what David's bringing. Like, you're going to bring some bread and some cheese, and, like, everybody's going to have a great time. I mean, they got to eat something while they're just sitting around waiting for the next day for this giant to come out and torment them because they're doing nothing else. Just getting fat on meat and cheese. He goes on, see how your brothers are getting along. Bring back a report on how they're doing. David's brothers were with Saul in the Israelite army at the Valley of Elah, fighting against the Philistines. I really feel like fighting there should be like the air quote. Verse 20, so David left the sheep with another shepherd, set out early the next morning with the gifts, as Jesse had directed him. He arrived at the camp just as the Israelite army was leaving for the battlefield with shouts and battle cries. Verse 21, soon the Israelite and Philistine forces stood facing each other, army against army, and David left his things with the keeper of supplies and hurried out to the ranks to greet his brothers. And as he was talking with them, Goliath, the Philistine champion from Gath, came out from the Philistine ranks. And then David heard him shout his usual taunt to the army of Israel. And as soon as the Israelite army saw him, they began to run away in fright. Have you seen the giant? The men asked. He comes out each day to defy Israel. The king has offered a huge reward to anyone who kills him, and he will give that man one of his daughters for a wife, and the man's entire family will be exempt from paying taxes. In Saul's desire to pursue comfort, not only has he now lost his willingness to fight the giant, but I would argue to say Saul has now lost his faith. His unwillingness to stand up to Goliath doesn't just illustrate that he's lost the willingness to fight, but he's lost his faith along the way as well. I mean, you think of all the stories you know in Scripture about the most unlikely person standing in the gap in faith, believing that God would be there, that God would deal, that God would handle. Saul, even without God, could probably make a case that he could handle Goliath on his own. How much more with God? He won't do it. He's lost faith in himself, faith in God, and is just seeking 40 days of comfort. There was a time in Saul's life when his faith in God was much stronger. There was a time in his life when he relied on God. But today, he's just willing to pay someone else, even a boy, to stand in the gap for him. And then this happens. A couple verses later, verse 32 of chapter 17, David says, don't worry about this Philistine. I'll go fight him. This boy, Saul, come on. Don't worry about. Worry about Goliath. I got it. This day in this story, David's faith is going to grow tremendously. And not only is his faith going to grow, but the purpose for David's life is going to take a huge leap forward. David's going to be on the path he's supposed to be on. God's purpose for David will continue to grow, but definitely took a jump in this moment. But also in this moment, Saul's faith is going to weaken. His faith will be weaker at the end of this day of battle. And he is going to drift further from God. And it is going to have a devastating consequence on his life. It's going to be the beginning of the end for Saul. For what he was unwilling to do in 40 days, David's going to take care of in about 40 minutes. So here's the conclusion today. Are you a Saul or a David? I believe in the question that Louis Giglio threw out when it comes to the church in America, is that there are churches all across America filled with comfortable people. That is the desire is comfort. Because as I talk to and watch people in the Christian community as a whole, not just like a local grouping, but just as I read and I take in a lot of information about the church in America and how the church is doing, most people only want to go to churches that cater to their comfort. And they want churches to cater to their comfort. I mean, they want churches to spend hundreds of thousands of dollars to have a professional worship experience. That somehow all of the fanfare and hoopla is what's required to worship God instead of the condition of their own heart individually. They demand that their children are entertained at church and all the programs they're at so that the children will want to come back. That's the goal. Entertain my child in such a way that they want to come back. But the moment that there's a church that does it a little bit better or hires a better CEO pastor that communicates a little better, tells funnier jokes, that has a nice strong Twitter account, the moment they find that, they jump ship. And they head to the next thing, the next flash that they see. And the church has to beg these people to serve. Beg them to get involved. Beg them to love their community. They have hard times being able to get them to help remove snow or sign up for a mobile food bank, or to give sacrificially in a financial way for the programs in the church that they demand is given to them. I have asked people before that have attended Hillcrest, why do you attend Hillcrest? Like, what is it about Hillcrest that you like? And there are times that I hear the answer to that, and I do everything I can to not lose it when I hear this answer. So if I ever ask you this, don't answer this way. If you fall into this category, that is. Because I'll have people that say, I like being a part of a church that serves the community. And they themselves never serve. I want to ride the coattails of the service of others. I like to say that I'm a part of a church that serves because I feel good about that. Yet the person never steps into service. It's comfortable. And the thought of serving, the thought of giving, the thought of doing some of these things is uncomfortable, is going to create discomfort. There's a reason why the church flourishes in countries where it is illegal to do church. Because faith grows in discomfort. There's also a reason why the church, I believe, is weakening in America. What we see happening today in America is that the have it your way church experience has made comfort our goal. Let's just be comfortable. Now here at Hillcrest, I would say we have pretty darn good participation. We had over 70 people at our first Hillcrest Serves event, and it was amazing. People made frozen meals for women and people who are coming out of human trafficking, and they're going to go to special housing with Call to Freedom. And when they get there, their first time back out of that horrific situation, when they are ready and they are settled and that they're there maybe alone that first evening, they're going to open that freezer where they're told, and in there is going to be a meal that they're going to pop in and have their first warm, safe meal. 30 of those meals were made here. And they wait in a freezer for the most important person that could eat that meal. And people put themselves out of whatever was going to happen on that day to have some discomfort for the sake of another person. And that's what moves the gospel forward. We had over 40 people helping with the mobile food bank. So many people, we had more than we even needed to do that. And there's been other times we've had 5, 6, 7, 8 people, not enough to do it. And that was on a seriously cold night. Well, here it comes up this week again, right, Aaron? We got it on Wednesday. Have you signed up? Do you want to be a part of that? Do you want to do that? Because people still need food no matter how cold it is. In fact, even more so. We have people here at Hillcrest that give sacrificially, faithfully, because they believe in what is happening here, and they want to give to something that matters. So this here is my invitation to you, and if need be, it's my plea to you. If you have not plugged in or been a part of the work of God here at Hillcrest, and in this community that we're serving, I want to encourage you to be okay with discomfort and start. To sign up for something, to get involved, to do what it is that God is calling you to do. Because if you feel like your life isn't the way it should be, or you feel like your faith isn't growing like it needs to grow, I want to ask you a question. Have you, or how have you, purposely chosen discomfort in the year 2023? Have you chosen to do something and allowed yourself to experience discomfort since 2023 started? Where have you served or where have you been involved? Have you financially contributed to the church that you're attending? And maybe it is time to make a change. Maybe it's time to allow discomfort into your faith journey. Maybe what I'm saying right now is creating discomfort, and maybe that is just what you need. Because remember, faith thrives in discomfort. Though it wouldn't be wrong, worship team's going to come on up here, but though it wouldn't be wrong, I don't think the response from today is for you to be praying, God, create more discomfort moments in my life. Make me more uncomfortable. That's maybe not a wrong prayer, but I'm not sure that's the best response for today. I believe a more realistic approach is a twofold response. The first thing would be this. Don't make comfort your goal. Strive for that first. Just try not to make comfort your goal in all situations and allow some discomfort so that you can step into something more beneficial and you can grow along the way. So don't pursue just that comfort, but accept that discomfort. Accept that. Don't make comfort your goal. But then the second thing, which is very closely related to it, is realize and take advantage of the benefits that exist in your discomfort or pain. So when the discomfort is there, instead of resisting it and saying, how can I get rid of this discomfort and get back to comfort, accept that it's there and realize that in that discomfort is the opportunity for you to grow and probably the opportunity to do something significant. Step into someone's discomfort. Let someone step into your discomfort. Whatever it is that God brings you, He'll be with you. He promises that, to guide and direct you along the way. We must not live such comfortable lives that we miss out on the purpose for our lives. And even worse, we must not live such comfortable lives that we have no real need for Jesus. I think there's a lot of people in our world today that when you read, like, heaven is a land of milk and honey, people are like, well, I don't want that. And that was a way back then of saying, like, milk, that was tough to come by. Honey, this sweet thing that you collect from bees and only in certain places. Like, those were like, it's plentiful, milk and honey. People are like, I got plenty of milk and honey, folks. I got big screen TV, game's going to be on. I got wings. I have everything. I got the nice car. I got a nice house. What could heaven possibly give me? Salvation. Eternal life. You see, we can't live such comfortable lives that we have no need for Jesus. And He literally said when He came here, I didn't come for those that don't need a doctor. I didn't come here for those that don't need me. I came for those that do. Those that are broken. Those that are hurting. Those that are suffering, those that are going through difficulty, those that are experiencing hardship, those that have no clue what to do. those that are marginalized, those that are oppressed, those that cry. That's who I came for. And friends, if we're honest, that should be all of us. Let's stand as we sing.
Why can't I say?
Father God, I ask that you would help us in this journey that we are on to recognize the value of discomfort, to recognize that it is a tool that you can use to advance the work you want to do in us. It's something that can help us become a better version of ourselves, that it's something that we can use to make your kingdom come, for your will to be done on earth as it is in heaven. And so, Lord, I pray that you would help us in that journey, not to avoid it. Lord, it is a difficult task in a world that is so focused on this, but if we were honest, also has done a poor job of finding it. For what might be comfortable in a moment becomes pain in another, and that the troubles and the struggles and the difficulties are always there under the surface. So Lord, help us to step into that and to see your miracle, to see your work through our difficulty and suffering, or through the difficulty and suffering of others that we step into. We thank you that you love us, that you've committed to that. We thank you for stories like the story of David and Goliath that encourages us to step into those uncomfortable moments, to live in discomfort, because you said you'd be with us, and that we don't fight the battles, that you fight them for us. Thank you for your love. Thank you for the commitment that you make to us. Help us to live out our commitment to you. We love you. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, have an amazing day celebrating whatever team you are for, or just celebrating, like, you know, maybe it's just you don't care what team it is, so when the Wings come out of the oven, just say, go Wings! You know, like, whatever you have to celebrate for. But have a lot of fun with friends and family, those that you might be connecting with today. Next week, the giant of anger must fall. So we'll hit that one next week. God bless you. Thank you for coming today. You are dismissed.